We're now ready to start talking about more analytical methods. We're going to start with cluster analysis, also known as clustering or segmentation, which is an exploratory analysis, a little bit similar to visualization. Here we don't have a model in mind, and instead we're looking for patterns of interest. And patterns here mean groups or clusters of records. Let's first look at a few examples. So this is an article from the Economic Times in 2011 talking about different companies in India using clustering. Kingfisher Airlines, although this might be a slightly dated example, was using clustering to help and find out what was the profile of their travelers on their Bangkok sector. They were able to discover that the type of people who were using these flights were traders, and we're not talking about financial traders, and they cared a lot more about excess baggage than about upgrades. Another example is Shoppers Stop First Citizen Loyalty Program. So Shoppers Stop is a very large chain, and they have a loyalty program, and using the data from the loyalty program, they were able to cluster their customers and find different types of interesting commonalities across clusters of customers. So finding clusters can be useful either directly in terms of implementing new strategies or marketing offers, or it can be used as a preliminary step into the data analysis that will follow. If we're doing predictive analytics, we might, instead of looking at 3 zillion customers, we might be looking at thousands of clusters of customers as our records of interest. So what is cluster analysis? It's an exploratory method for identifying homogeneous groups of records. We're looking for groups of records that are similar to each other and are different from records in other groups. So similar records should belong in the same cluster, and dissimilar records should belong in different clusters. Here's a very, very picturesque example. Suppose that we're looking at each one of the people on this slide, and we have measurements about their sex, whether they wear glasses, whether they have a mustache or not, whether they're smiling in this photo, and whether they're wearing a hat. And suppose that we're trying to identify clusters of similar people just based on these measurements. How would we be able to do that? This is such a small example with only 12 people and only 6 measurements. How can we quickly determine what are natural clusters of people here? The idea is to use algorithmic methods that will measure distances between people in a quick way that will generate these clusters for us. So we're expanding in the number of records and in the number of measurements. There are plenty of other nice examples on a website that unfortunately no longer exists. It might be hiding somewhere else on the web. Here's a simple example where we only have 2 measurements, and since there are only 2 measurements, I can plot this on a scatter plot. The example here is studying the relationship between the brightness of stars and their temperatures, and you can see we have brightness or luminosity on the y-axis and temperature on the x-axis. Each one of the dots here is a star, and we can see that the stars cluster. We can very easily identify 3 clusters of stars. And this is a very neat way of identifying things just by creating the right chart. This is easy when you have 2 measurements, but what if I had 20 measurements? Then creating charts is not so easy. And that's where we need to move to algorithmic methods. Here's another example, and this example shows that you really need to be creative about what you want to do with the clustering. It's not just a mechanical run a menu and get some clusters. This is about thinking carefully about which measurements, what are we trying to achieve, and whether the resulting clusters are insightful or useful. If not, we shouldn't report any of this stuff, and this goes back into the dump of data exploration. So the example here, let me read from the slide. The United States Army recently commissioned a study on how to redesign the uniforms of female soldiers. The Army's goal is to reduce the number of different uniform sizes that have been kept in inventory, while still providing each soldier with well-fitting khakis. Researchers Ashdown and Paul at Cornell University designed a new set of sizes based on the actual shapes of women in the Army. Unlike traditional clothing systems, the new sizes are not an ordered set of graduated sizes where all dimensions increase together. You've probably had the experience of trying to buy a shirt that has sleeves that are too long if you need it to be longer in length or bigger in size, or sleeves that are too short when you're shrinking down the size in the shoulders. So they're trying to move away from these graduated sizes. Here's what they came up with. Instead, they came up with sizes that fit particular body types. For example, one type is short-legged, small-waisted, large-busted women with long torsos, average arms, broad shoulders, and skinny necks. Now, this might sound amusing, but if you think about it for a minute, if there really is a common type of woman that has these dimensions, then indeed creating a certain uniform of this size makes a lot of sense in terms of inventory and availability. Clustering is extremely popular in market segmentation, and the well-known company Claritas created these clusters of customers that are based on demographics and transaction history. And you might have heard some of these names, such as New Beginnings, Middleburg Managers, Country Casuals. And often companies will actually use these types of segments in order to cater to their customers in a more personalized way. Clustering can be used in any field where you have data and measurements and you're trying to cluster records. Recall that records don't have to be individuals or customers. For example, if we think of investment, we can think of securities as the records. And then we might cluster securities based on financial performance and on other information such as industry and market capitalization, etc. So if you want to build a portfolio that has securities that are different, because that's the idea of portfolios, you might want to cluster the securities into segments and then pick and choose securities from different segments to bundle into your portfolio. So many different ways of using clustering. In industry analysis, you might cluster firms, so your records might be firms, and you might cluster them based on different measurements, such as growth rate, profitability, market size, etc. And this will help you understand the industry structure. If you know that these firms are in this cluster, and they're different from those firms that are in another cluster, that gives you an idea of what's going on in the terrain of the industry. We're going to be using a very small example to illustrate two main algorithms used for clustering. And this example is undergraduate business programs in the United States. And in particular, we're looking at the ratings by the U.S. News and World Report. This is an old data set from 1995, but nevertheless, this can be applied to any data set of interest. What we're going to have here are universities are going to be individual records, and for each university, we have a bunch of measurements that the U.S. News reports. We have information on student quality, such as their SAT grades. We have program quality in terms of the acceptance ratio, student to faculty ratio, and expenses, how expensive is the program. And we have placement information about the graduation rate. Of course, there can be many other types of measurements, but we're going to focus on these just for simplicity. Let me tell you that this particular data set excludes image variables, things like student satisfaction and employer satisfaction that are also typically reported in these types of rankings. But of course, you can add them in if you can extract some numerical measurements out of this text. So the question is, why do you want to class cluster? And the answer is going to be, well, let me think if I can use the clustering to help the stakeholder. I'm not just going to cluster because I can do it. But why am I going to cluster? How is that going to be used is the question that I need to keep in mind. I'm also going to ask, for instance, in this example, who is my stakeholder? In our little example here, we can think about two different stakeholders. One is an applicant. So maybe you're a student and or you're a potential student and you're thinking, which program, which business program should I actually apply to? If I can bundle the different universities into similar types of programs, that might help me choose. How about if you're the dean of a business school? Why would you care about clustering? Well, you're a very different stakeholder, and clustering would really have to be tailored in a slightly different way. But the results of clustering can tell me a lot about who my competitors are, who are similar to me and different from me, etc. So you always have to keep in mind also the business stakeholder. What we're going to do in the next sessions is go behind the stage. And I'm going to start with a very, very simple explanation of what's going on algorithmically. So let's start with the question of what are we actually trying to do when we're doing clustering? If I have only a single or two measurements, then what we're doing is we're actually looking for the gaps. For instance, when professors are grading exams or papers and we assign some kind of a numerical grade, how do we turn those numerical grades into letter grades such as A, B, C, and D? There's a funny example of a professor who gives the example of just throwing all the papers down the stairs and then putting cut points depending on which step the paper fell on. But obviously what we're looking for are the gaps. Is there a big gap between the very high grades and the next level of grades? So we're actually doing something similar when we move beyond one or two variables. There are going to be two basic approaches that algorithms use. One is to think about distances and to compute a distance between records that take into account the entire set of measurements. That's what we call the multivariate distance. What we want to do is to group close records that have a short multivariate distance. A different approach is to look at the homogeneity of a group. So if I have a group of records, I want to check whether it's homogeneous and remove all those records that make it too heterogeneous. So those are two different approaches, and we'll see algorithms using this one or the other. We're going to look at two types of algorithms that are the most popular. One is called hierarchical clustering, and in general we have hierarchical methods versus non-hierarchical methods. In hierarchical methods, we're going to be starting with n clusters, and usually n is equal to the sample size, so each record is a sample, and then we start bunching together records that are similar until we end up with the number of groups that we care about. This is useful when we're looking for some natural hierarchy, but it's also going to require us to define some kind of a distance metric. What is a distance between two records? The other types of algorithm is non-hierarchical, and what we do here is we don't have any hierarchy going on, but we pre-specify the number of clusters that we want, say 10 or 5, and then we start allocating the records into the different groups until we get an allocation that gives us the smallest heterogeneity within each group and the biggest heterogeneity across the different groups. So this is going to require us to specify how many clusters we need. But the biggest advantage of these methods is that they're very computationally cheap, so in very large applications, this is the type of algorithm that's running behind the scenes. In our next modules, we're going to get into deeper detail into hierarchical methods and into non-hierarchical methods.